You write in the book that you initially thought it was simply what you called a White House staff problem, but you came to realize, and I'm quoting from the book right now, it was a Trump problem and it never got fixed. What is the Trump problem?
Well, this the incident you cite is a discussion that I had with John Kelly within, I think, about 10 days after joining the White House, where a briefing in preparation for a meeting with Prime Minister Shinzo Abe of Japan had been disrupted. We didn't get to the subjects we wanted to. The first suggestion that was made to the president was to thank Abe for being such a close ally of the United States, and he started talking about Japan attacking Pearl Harbor. So I had this discussion with John Kelly, and I said, this is a staff problem. He said, no, it's not. And I say in the book, and I believe it, Kelly was right and I was wrong. The confusion, the lack of systematic analysis and study on the part of the president makes it very hard to have a successful, long-term, sustained policy. And so the United States suffers damage from that, whether you agree with the policy or not, because we get a reputation for being fickle and inconsistent. That harms the United States no matter what direction the policy's in.
Because you make there's a long list in your book of White House officials who clearly failed to impose any order or specific influence on the president. John Kelly, James Mattis, I got a list here, H.R. McMaster, Reince Priebus, Sean Spicer, Steve Bannon, Rex Tillerson, among them. Why do you think they failed in their effort to have some serious discipline over there?
Well, I think there were a lot of different reasons. I don't think it was necessarily inevitable we're in the chaos that we are now. Other people tell me that even today that's a fatuous idea, that Trump will be Trump and nothing can correct it. But I believed when I went into the government, and people will read the book and decide whether I was right or wrong, that we could do better. I don't think I succeeded, so I'll join the list of people who couldn't get order. But in the potentially deadly area of national security, it's very important for presidents to make considered decisions. I'm a conservative Republican. I have been since I handed out leaflets for Barry Goldwater in 1964. We're not dealing with a president that has a philosophy. I'm not saying he's a squishy liberal Democrat. He doesn't have any philosophy at all. And I think that's a problem, too.
Let's get to some of the specific charges, allegations you make in the book. You write about the president's, what you call, habit of giving personal favors to dictators he liked. Your words, dictators he liked, including Russian President Putin, Chinese President Xi, Turkish President Erdogan, among others. Why do you think he's tougher on traditional American allies than he is on these authoritarian strongmen?
Yeah. Well, may I say, that's not only my characterization. The president himself said early in my tenure at the White House, we were going off to a NATO summit, a summit with Theresa May in Great Britain, and then the meeting with Putin in Helsinki. And he said, I think as he left the White House, you know, who knows, the meeting with Putin may be the easiest of all. Who would have thought that? Well, I certainly didn't think that, and I don't think any of his other senior advisors did, too. I think in part it's because the president personalizes policy. I don't doubt that relations between top leaders, personal relations can be important, but personal relations are not the equivalent of the actual relationship between two countries. So being a big guy, talking to other big guys, you know, talking the way big guys talk, why don't you do something about the prosecution of Hawk Bank, that sort of thing. Maybe that is something the president enjoyed. I'm not a shrink. I'm not going to second guess it. I just think it was bad for the country.
You write in the book, and this is a very alarming part of the book, you write that President Trump actually encouraged the Chinese President Xi to continue building detention camps for, what, a million Muslim Uyghurs there, that the president of the United States gave a green light to a major human rights abuse. But what was surprising to me is you only devoted, a couple paragraphs or so to that revelation, which was so outrageous, so significant. Why not tell more about it in the book? Because it was sort of covered very briefly. You make the allegation and then move on.
Yeah. The book's 500 pages long. If Simon & Schuster had given me 1,000 pages, I could have filled them. There's plenty more where that comes from, none of it involving classified information. It's part of the continuing chaos in the White House, and the signal that it sends to Xi Jinping that he can act essentially with impunity across a wide range of issues.
But weren't you outraged by that when you heard him say that?
Well, I was equally outraged when he told me told Secretary of Commerce Wilbur Ross to stop basically the interagency consideration of sanctions that we were looking at recommending to him to impose on China because of the treatment of the Uyghurs. Same situation came up with respect to the demonstrators in Hong Kong, with respect to a statement marking the anniversary of the suppression of the Tiananmen Square demonstrations. It came up over and over.
Did you tell the president, Mr. President, with all due respect, this is outrageous. You should not be doing this. You should not be encouraging the Chinese to build these detention camps for these Muslims.
We had conversations on all these subjects. My objective was to try to persuade him to do the right thing. I'm not, I think it's fair to say, I'm not a virtue signaler. I wasn't playing West Wing on TV. I thought, for example, that pursuing the repression of the Uyghurs was something that was important for the United States. I got absolutely nowhere.
So you raised it with him and you complained to him. You weren't necessarily silent, were you?
No, of course not. The issue for anybody who works in an administration, particularly like this, is how many times you can make a recommendation and get rejected. The fact is, and I said this repeatedly in public when I was there, I was the national security advisor. I was not the national security decision maker. I understood who was in charge. So I would make recommendations, as would others in the administration. I was certainly not the only one. And you don't expect to win every battle. You're not, as Jim Baker, one of his favorite phrases to describe George H.W. Bush was, he was the guy who got elected. I was not the guy who got elected. I understand that. So just because he doesn't take my recommendation, even on an important point, is not alone grounds for resignation. At least that was my view. It's the number of rocks in the bottom of the boat that it finally took in my case, and I think in the case of many others, finally, before they left.
I want you to stand by. There's a lot more we need to discuss. Ambassador, do you trust the president with the nuclear codes?
Yes, and I do that because I think in the circumstances where the United States might face the enormous consequential decisions where those codes would be involved, that the combined weight of all of the advisors, whoever they might be at that time, would be serious enough to have us believe we could get the responsible decisions. But I also think that it's something that the American people should pay more attention to in all presidential elections. I've spent my public career in national security. I formed a PAC and a super PAC some years back to stress foreign and defense policy issues. I think perhaps since the end of the Cold War, there has not been enough attention on national security issues in American politics. And the coronavirus, as the possible, hopefully not obviously, but possible precursor of a biological weapons attack on the United States, should give all of us pause, because our adversaries have seen the result of this pandemic, and it should not fill us with confidence they believe we would know how to handle it.
I asked the question because you write in the book that Putin and North Korea's Kim Jong-un have gotten a laugh out of Trump, and you told ABC News that Putin, quote, can play him like a fiddle. So which world leaders respect the president the most, based on what you personally saw as the national security advisor in the White House? Which world leaders respect him the least?
Look, I think they all respect him in the sense that they know the United States remains the most powerful country in the world. And my hope for the future is that we can repair the damage I think the president's done in many of our international relations. And I think these other world leaders are hardcore realists in their approach. And they know the strength of the United States, whoever the president is. I think we can repair the damage of one Trump term. I'm not so certain about repairing the damage of two.
Well, we're going to get to some of the politics of that shortly. But you also, in the book, describe what you call a sympathetic working relationship with the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo. You write that when you discussed resigning with him on multiple occasions, he indicated he would resign with you. Was it common within the Trump administration to hear cabinet secretaries talk possibly about resignations?
Well, I think at least for some of us, we almost joked about it. I had a two-sentence letter of resignation written for quite some time before I actually pulled it out of the drawer and made it effective. You could look at the trajectory of senior advisors, senior officials in the administration, and it was perfectly apparent that that most people were leaving before serving anything like close to one term with the president. I knew that going in. I knew what people said about the president. I believed I could make it work. I did my best to try, and the history I've written in the book.
In the book, you also describe multiple Trump administration officials that you work closely with. But since the book came out and the allegations in the book, several of them, and I got a whole list, have come out and say basically you're a liar. Secretary of State Pompeo, Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer, Economic Advisor Peter Navarro, Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin. So the question is, why should Americans believe you as opposed to them?
Well, I have written the best recollection I could of the events I describe in the book. I've tried hard, as I did in my first book about the Bush 43 administration, to portray an accurate picture of what's going on. People who have a different view of that are certainly free to bring their story forward. I'm a former litigator. This is how the truth emerges. I'm confident in my version. I stand by it.